Now his daughter-in-law, Phinehas' wife, was with child, due to be delivered. And when she heard the news that the ark of God was captured, and that her father-in-law and her husband were dead, she bowed down herself and gave birth, for her labor pains came upon her. And about the time of her death, the woman who stood by her said to her, "Do not fear, for you have born a son." But she did not answer, nor did she regard it. Then she said, "The child Ichabod, saying, the glory has departed from Israel, because the ark of God had departed, had been captured, and because of her father-in-law and her husband." And she said, "The glory has departed from Israel, for the ark of God has been captured." May God bless the reading of his word. Now there was a man that was called Alexander the Great. I'm sure everyone is familiar with that name. Alexander the Great is known of winning wars. He is known of winning everything that came to him, as long as it was an outward war. But the historians record that in the death of Alexander, the man failed to conquer his inward weaknesses. The man is recorded to have been killed by alcohol, yet the man was unconquerable by other armies. And the historians further say, some argue and say, the man was killed by food. And this man named Alexander the Great, he had a mentor whose name was Aristotle. Aristotle was a philosopher who says, who devised a theory that was called the virtue theory. The man says, a human being is not born virtuous. He says, being virtuous is not something that you read about in the books. He says, for you to become virtuous, you have to practice being virtuous. When you see someone who is virtuous, you can imitate their works and become virtuous. It is not something that you read in the books. When we come to our scripture here, the Bible begins by saying, now his daughter-in-law, meaning the verse has got a beginning somewhere. When you read from the book of 1 Samuel chapter 2, we are introduced to Eli the priest. And we are also introduced to the sons that are called Phinehas and Hophni. And there is a wife also involved. And the Bible records that Phinehas and Hophni were the child of the priest, but there were people that were disobedient. And the priest allowed them to do as they pleased. The Bible says, back then, when people come to sacrifice in the temple, they will come with their meat, their sacrificial meat, and it is required that when they bless the meat in the boiling water, the priest is required to bless only the fork and take that which came out of the fork. But the Bible says Phinehas and Hophni stood in the temple and required all the sacrifices that were brought by people. It does not only end there. The Bible also records that these two gentlemen were standing in the temple and they could use the ladies that were in the temple for their own pleasure in the house of God. You see, back then it was not strange for temples of worship to be known. And when I talk about the temples of worship, I am talking about from the Genesis narrative, when the Bible says, my director, when the Bible says, Adam knew Eve and she had a son. Then back then it was not strange for the temple to be known that this is the temple of prostitution. Therefore, when you want to practice prostitution, you were allowed by the law. Therefore, it was not strange for you to be found in the temple worship, whereby you will be engaged in another form of worship, because it is the temple of prostitution. The Bible says Phinehas and Hophni practiced this bad habit in the house of God. And these gentlemen were the sons, when we call them PKs, we can just call them PKs, pastor's kids. Because Eli was a priest. These two gentlemen were the sons of a priest. Therefore, the gentlemen were the PKs of today. And the father, Eli, knew about their doings in the temple. But the Bible records, when you go to 1 Samuel chapter 3, to 1 Samuel chapter 2, going to 3, that there was a son that was born, and this son was called Samuel. And the Bible then says, Samuel was called by God. And Eli, the priest himself, is the one who said to Samuel, when this voice calls you again, respond and say, here I am, O Lord, speak to me. And the voice called Samuel, and Samuel responded and said, here I am, O Lord, speak to me. Lo and behold, and the voice that spoke was giving a decree to Eli himself, who said to Samuel, when you hear the voice, say to the Lord, speak to me, O Lord. The voice was saying to Samuel, the house of Eli has been judged. Because Eli has seen what the children are practicing in the house of God. And he is quiet about it. Therefore, the house of Eli has been judged. This is a story that you find when you are reading 1 Samuel. And Samuel goes to Eli. And he gives the message as it is to Eli. So Eli knows about something that is yet to happen, which has not yet happened. For the decree is given in chapter 3. But the consequences, or rather the application of the message, is only applicable in chapter 4. Allow me today to say, God has given us his message. God has given us some warnings. It might be that the application of the message has not been applied in our lives, but the decree has been given. The sermon is titled, Where is the Glory? Let's preach together, church. Where is the glory? Where is the glory? Let's preach together. My youth, do not be angry. Where is the glory? Where is the glory? In summary, it says, Ichabod, for the child was born, and the wife named the child Ichabod, and the meaning of the name was, where is the glory? For the glory of God has departed from Israel. For the glory of God, rather, God himself has been exiled from the children of Israel. Therefore, where is the glory? I want to be in the church. Where is the glory? A messenger runs, when you get to chapter 4, a messenger runs to Eli. You know, when you do crime, there are some people that will never be caught, that will just be messengers. Have you ever been as a group where you are involved in something, but there's that one person who will never be caught? They only report the incident. Even in crime, there are guys that are in prison. When you hear their stories, they will tell you that the person who introduced me into this is not in prison, but they are in prison. Might be that someone out there has a friend. Friends who never get caught, even when you're writing exams. When you decide to cheat, the one who says let's cheat, they are never caught. But the one who follows is the one who is caught. And when you go to war, there are people who report a message, who are never killed in war, yet they were in war. Therefore, when you get to chapter 4, it says, there is a messenger who came running to the house of Eli. And this man was terrified and trembled. He gets to Eli and he says to him, I am bringing the bad news. The Israelites have been conquered. The army has been defeated. It does not only end there. Your sons, Phinehas and Hophni, are dead. Then he says, it does not only end there. The ark of God has been captured. This happens because the Israelites had adopted the concept of the Philistines. For the Philistines worshipped a god that was called Dagon. Therefore, they thought that when they move with the ark of God, they can manipulate God and the enemy himself. For when the Philistines saw the ark of God, the Bible records that they were terrified, for they thought that God is with the ark. Allow me today to say that the ark can be a representation of the church. Coming to church does not mean one comes with God. Being here does not mean the glory of God is here. Where is the glory? The ark of the covenant was with the Israelites when they went to army. And funny enough, the Bible says in chapter 1, of verse 1 of chapter 4, the Bible says they were defeated. But when they went with the ark of God, the Bible emphasizes that it says the defeat when they went with the ark of God was greater than the one that they occurred when the ark of God had remained behind. Can it be that sometimes when you thought you are walking with God, things get worse than they were before? Can it be that when you thought God is with you, when you thought you are going with God, things get worse than they are? Because it is all in the mind of a human being. They thought God was the ark of the covenant. But the Bible says the defeat when they went to the ark of the covenant was greater than before. The Bible then says, the messenger reports this, and Eli was sitting on a chair. The Bible says when he heard Now, follow this closely. Eli is not so concerned about the death of his two kids, because he knows already from the previous chapters that the Bible says they will be killed together. So he knows that these will be killed. When the messenger comes with the message, Eli is not so concerned about his kids, but he's concerned about the ark of the covenant that has been captured. For when the messenger says the ark of God has been captured, the Bible says the man was sitting on a chair. The moment he heard that the ark of God has been captured, he fell on his back and he died the same time. Because the ark of God was captured. The ark of God was captured not because at that moment the glory had departed. The glory of God had departed already when Samuel was born. Because the Israelites had a tendency of disobeying God. Now when they disobey God, God on his side had a tendency of bringing enemies to infiltrate the kingdom of the Israelites. Not so he can harm them, but so he can teach them a lesson. In one account, He takes them from Jerusalem into the land of Babylon. But when you read from Daniel chapter 1, it says, the king of Babylon is the one that captured the Israelites. But when you read in verse 3, it will say, God himself is the one who gave the Israelites to the king of Babylon. Sometimes the things that we go through, it is not the devil who is responsible. It is God who has allowed it to happen. Not so he can harm us, but so we can follow his ways. It is God who has allowed it to happen. And he says, for I know the plans that I've got for you. The plans not to harm you. The plans to make you prosper. Now, the message is filled with a lot of confusion. How does God say, I know the plans that I've got for you, when the Ark of the Covenant has been captured? How does God say, I know the plans that I've got for you, when his children are in Babylon, under someone's authority? How does God say, for I know the plans that I've got for you, the plans to make you prosper when I'm in exile? How does God say that when I don't have money to pay school fees? How does God say that when you can't find a job? How does God say that when as a youth, you think you are walking with God, and God say, oh, I know the plans that I've got for you, but things are going south? How does God say that? For he knows that where you are is a dead camp. It's not a permanent position. For he knows. Then the Bible says, the message comes to the wife of Eli. And she's told, now chapter 4 is a chapter that is filled with too much fear, too much defeat, and the absence of God in the presence of the Ark of the Covenant. It's a chapter that is filled with the absence of God in the presence of the Ark of the Covenant. When you get to our scripture, to our verse of consideration, the Bible then says, the news come to the wife of Eli, and they tell him that your father-in-law has passed away. The army has been defeated. This is a pregnant woman that has been told this. Your husband is dead, and the Ark of the Covenant has been captured. I don't know how it feels to be pregnant. I don't even know if this lady was due for labor yet, or it is because of the news that she had. But the Bible says, at that moment, the labor pains started to strike. And you should note that back then, people did not give birth the same way women of today give birth. Historians record that when they give birth, they would kneel in a kneeling position. And there was a rock that would be behind where she would be leaning on, yet on a kneeling position. Now you can imagine the news being told to a kneeling woman that your husband is dead, yet you're about to give birth. Not only your husband is dead, then your father-in-law has passed away as well. Not only your father-in-law has passed away, even God is no longer in the presence of the Israelites. Therefore, what is the use of giving birth? For in chapter 1, a woman gives birth and she celebrates the birth of Samuel. She celebrates. But when you get to chapter 4, a woman gives birth and she is in pain when she gives birth. She is not happy when she gives birth. She gives birth and the maiden, the ladies that are helping her, say to her, it is a boy for the Israelites to have a child who is a boy. It was an event that was to be celebrated, especially when you are a widow, for the child of a boy could give you the status in the community. But this day, when she gives birth, she does not enjoy the birth because the glory of God has departed. Are we together, church? The glory of God has departed. And she gives the child a name, Ichabod. The glory of God has departed. Now this incident happens just after Samson defeated the Philistines. It's recorded that this was during the reign, the 40-year reign of the Philistines. When you remember well, Samson was also a judge of Israel. And he's a man who died
with his enemies. A man who prayed to God and said, let me die with my enemies. And of course, I cannot conclude this story without marrying the two verses of 1 Samuel chapter 4, verse 19 to 22, with Judges 16. You cannot conclude without marrying the two verses. Judges 16 records that Samson went down to Gaza and he met a prostitute and he went into her. Allow me, children of God, to say sometimes you can go south, north, or east geographically, but that destination that you are taking can also have an effect in your spiritual destination. It can be a geographical navigation that will have an impact on your spiritual destination. Bible says he went down to Gaza. Now, when the presence of God leaves our lives, it does not leave instantly. And when the presence of God leaves our lives, it is not you. You know, when the glory of God leaves the presence of your life, it's like stupidity. Sorry to use the word, but it's stupidity. Now, a person who is not considerate does not care about themselves. And a person whom the glory of God has departed cannot see themselves. You can't see that the glory of God has departed your life. It is someone next to you who can see that the glory of God has departed your life. Now, the Bible says in Judges 16, verse 4, just to fast forward the event, for these go together. It says, he went down to Gaza and he met a prostitute and he went into her. That's verse 1. When you get to verse 4, it says, he went down again and he met a lady that was called Delilah and he fell in love with her. And when he fell in love with her, fast forward, when you go down to the last chapter, the Bible says, Delilah inquired, where does your power come from? And Samson says to her, I'm just fast forwarding. He says to her, my power comes from my head. And Delilah, because she is the servant of the enemy, she cut off the hair. And when she cuts off the hair, she informs the enemy that I have identified where the power is coming from. And the enemy says to Samson, Samson, the Philistines are approaching. Guess what Samson says, church? The Samson says, don't worry, baby. Don't worry, Delilah. I'll do likewise. That's his response. He says, don't worry. I'll do likewise. Our message today says, where is the glory? Samson says, do not worry, I will do likewise. At that moment when he says, do not worry, I will do likewise, he did not understand that the glory of God has departed from his life. He did not understand that the power that was with him has departed from his life. It might be that some of us here used to sing at times when we are told that come and sing. We say, oh, I'll do likewise. Some of us used to preach, and when we are invited, we say, I will do likewise. There is something that you used to do, and when they inquire from you, you say, I will do likewise, not knowing that the glory of God has departed from your life. This morning I'm bringing a message that says, refuse to be an Ichabod. Refuse to be an Ichabod. Refuse to walk alone as if you're walking with God. Refuse. You know, there are people that walk with the rich people. And when they are alone, they walk as if they are rich because of their associations. Their friends who walk with famous friends, and when they walk alone, they walk as if they are become also famous because of the friends that they work with. Samson says, I will do likewise, because he was working with God. Therefore, he thinks he is still working with God. Refuse to be an Ichabod. In conclusion, there's a man named Mahatma Gandhi. The man says, one day, as he was on a plane coming to South Africa, was going to Durban to be precise. He says, I was sitting reading the Bible. And as I was reading the Bible, I got so interested in the stories that I found in the Bible. And he says, when he reached Durban, he inquired, where can I find the Christians? Where can I fellowship with the Christians? For he was interested in what he found in the Bible. And the narrator records and says, Gandhi found the church of Christians, and he went to church, but lo and behold, to his surprise, what he had read about in the Bible is not what he found in the Christian church. It's not what he found the Christians practicing. Hence, there is a phrase that he said, that, oh Christ, I hate your Christians, but I love your Christ. For your Christians don't behave like the Christ that I read about. Then he says, there's a madman who came running and he says, they have killed God. They have killed God. And he says, who have killed God? He says, God has been killed by his own people. Because his own people preach one thing and live the other. Therefore, when they preach one thing and live the other, they have killed the one that they are preaching about. Where is the glory in the house of God? Are we carrying only the Ark of the Covenant without God, or God is also with us? Where is the glory of God? This afternoon, I want to challenge you to a self-introspection on your spiritual gift, on your journey with God, and ask yourself, where is the glory of God? Now, God is not a God who just leaves us hanging like that. For he says to us, all you who are heavy laden, come to me and I will give you rest. Where is the glory of God? The glory of God can only be found in God. May God bless you all. Amen.